when I have gotten everything out of following Christ, yes, I've got His love. No, His love, when His love has made so much difference in my life, when being in a community, this is not church, this is come in unity. This is communion. This is the breaking of the bread. This is the drinking of the wine. The wine is the Holy Spirit speaking to us. Understanding the word is the bread. Not taking the chapati and the sambar and dipping in your mouth, putting in your mouth. That's symbolic. If you don't do this and you do that, you miss the whole thing. We should do that, but what should come first? What if we don't do this and we do that? We bring death on ourselves. Paul says it. James 3:1. Don't be in any rush to become a teacher, my friends. Teaching is highly responsible work. Now, this is not school teacher or college teacher. It's teaching the word of God. Okay? Teachers are held to the strictest standards, and none of us is perfectly qualified. None of us are. None of us is perfectly qualified. If we get it wrong nearly every time we open our mouths, if we could find someone whose speech was perfectly true, you'd have a perfect person. So it talks about we cannot become teachers. Okay? Do not be in a rush to become a teacher. I mean, the teacher here means those who teach the word of God, of course. But Hebrews 5:12 says, anybody knows the scripture? Very powerful scripture. I mean, every scripture is powerful. 5. By this time, you ought to be teachers yourself. Yet here I find you need someone to sit down with you and go over the basics of God again, starting from square one, baby's milk, when you should have been on solid food long ago. Milk is for beginners, inexperienced in God's ways. Solid food is for the mature, who have some practice in telling right from wrong. So milk is for beginners. I mean, starting about what is a basic teaching about, there it is, 6:1. Let's leave the preschool finger painting exercise on Christ. Get on with grand work of art. Grow up in Christ. Leave the basic foundation truths like turning your back on salvation by self-help. That's religion. Turning your back on salvation by self-help. You know, own effort. Own effort. Turning your trust in God. Baptismal instructions. Laying on of hands, resurrection of the dead, eternal judgment. Okay. So talks about we cannot become children in knowing the things of God. We cannot be taking milk. We need to be taking strong meat. But if you take strong meat, what happens? We get indigestion because we are used to taking simple teaching, simple word, once a week, survive on 3 idlis. What happens if you eat only idlis on once a week and don't eat anything throughout the week? We become weak. We become malnutrition. Okay, so the word clearly says that, look at Jesus, he was with the Jewish people, the Sadducees, the Pharisees, who knew the word, from morning to night, day in, day out, they were meditating the scriptures. They were studying the scriptures. They knew the scriptures. They were the priest. They were fulfilling the commandment which God gave to Moses. Are they any better than us? Of course. 1,000 times better than us. Because they will not turn to the left or to the right, but observe everything to the T, to the dot. They observe the word of God so meticulously, so fearfully, so, what do we say? Terrible fear. With fear and trembling, they observe the word of God. Why they were so angry with Jesus? Simple reason. Most of his miracles was done on a Sabbath day. He was trying to put a stone on his own. He intended to do it. He didn't come to break the law. He came to fulfill the law. He wanted to emphasize that the Lord of the Sabbath is greater than the Sabbath of the Lord. He was trying to emphasize that the Lord, you can put the lights on, please. That the Lord who gave the scripture is more important than the scripture itself. The Lord who gave the scripture, the Lord of the word, is more important than the word of the Lord. What if you read the word, follow the word, do everything and don't obey the Lord in small things? We obey the Lord in big things. Baptism, communion, tithe offering, everything ready. But come to church before he comes. Too strong. It's not possible with me. How it will be possible with you? So there is something that we are missing. What is it? We need to honor the Lord and break the spirit of religion behind this. And then everything changes. I don't know whether you got that. Jesus, the Jewish people, the scribes, the teachers of the word, okay, those who know the word, those who read the word from childhood to old age, including the high priest, the priest, the teachers of the law knew the word, but did not know the word. Did not know the person called. So know the word means is not knowledge. Knowing the word means knowing the person. In the beginning was the word was with God, and the word was God. So word of God means person. Not theology, not head knowledge, not all that you read, all that you know, everything that you practice, no. That's why Bill Johnson says, knowing Jesus is perfect theology. Jesus is perfect theology. If you know Jesus, you know theology. And a child can understand Jesus. It's not that complicated. Some people know theology but do not know Christ. Certain people know Christ but don't know theology, which is better. So knowing Christ, you will know who is God. Right? So these people, they knew the scripture, they knew all the commandment, they did not know who gave the commandment. They observed the commandment, they followed the commandment, even they dressed according to the commandment. And the one who gave the commandment showed up, they ate with him. They saw him. They beheld his glory. John says, we handled him. We touched him. We saw his glory. What did they talk about? The physical Jesus? No. The Jesus revealed to them by the Holy Spirit. That was after the resurrection. John was not talking about the Jesus whom they saw before resurrection, before being revealed. The Jesus whom they saw while they were living their life on earth is totally different than the Christ whom they saw after resurrection. I hope you notice the word. I use two different words. What is the two different words? Jesus and Christ. Christ never died on the cross. Jesus died on the cross. Because Christ cannot die. He is God. You cannot kill God. Many people think Christ died on the cross. No. It was the body of Christ which had a name called Jesus. I hope you're getting this. He enacted Do you understand the word enacted? He acted on the cross. What he did as a Christ before even the earth was created. The Lamb of God that was killed before the foundation of the world. Jesus did not die 2,000 years ago. Oh, every heresy begins with every new revelation looks like a heresy. Because we've been believing religion. It was a humanity or human form of Jesus that died, not the divinity of Christ. He was fully man, he was fully God. He was 100% man, he 100% God. He knew no sin, he did no sin, he had no sin. He had no sickness. But God put all the sickness of the world, all the sin of the world, past, present, and future, the whole thing called sin, sickness, curse, poverty, religion, ignorance, everything that came through Adam, everything, he put it forcefully on Jesus and finished with it once and for all. Sin doesn't exist anymore in heaven or on earth. Isn't it amazing? Once and for all, it's done. It is finished, he said. And still now we are crying, Jesus, please forgive my sins. Deliver me from curse. Go through 7 steps of inner healing. Sozo. Outer healing. Somebody asked me. They got so offended by asking, by the answer that I gave. Pastor, do you do deliverance? Okay, tell me what. What do you mean deliverance? Do you cast out demons from Christians or anybody? I said, no, I don't cast out demons from Christians. I cast out Christians from the demons. The problem is never with demons. The problem is always with Christians. So I am trying to save the devil from Christian. The devil cannot have Christians, but Christians can have demons. And they don't want to let go. Somebody has to come and pull it out of his hand. Do you understand that? He got so offended.
So the Bible says Jesus cast out demons.
Yeah, he cast out demons from Christians. I mean, from those people who lived on those place over. Others did not want to let go. So the problem is never with demons. The problem is with you. I mean, Derek Prince says it very beautifully. You cannot be possessed. Devil cannot possess a Christian. But Christian can possess a demon. Possess means control, take total control. Devil is not authorized to take complete control of any human being. Look at the legion, 6,000 or 8,000 demons. When Jesus came, that man could still come and kneel before him and worship him. Having 8,000 demons, the 8,000 demons could not stop him from kneeling before Jesus Christ. 8,000 demons could not stop this man from coming to Jesus and kneel down. In fact, they all would have helped him. We want to get out of your body. Please, the only one person who can help us get out of you is this Jesus. So please, can you kneel before him? Daniel, he knelt. What next? He said, what do you want? Just command us to leave. Okay, go. They did not go. Why are you not going? It's not one of us. I'm only representing, but there are 8,000. We are a legion. We are an army. Okay, 8,000. How are you going to go? Where are you going to go? Don't worry about that, Jesus. We have arranged our own transportation. We have pigs for transportation. How many pigs? There's only 2,000. There are 8,000, 6,000 here. No, four of us, pillion rider. Four demons sitting on one motorbike. One pig, poor pig. Four demons have to sit on one pig. 4 into 2, 8,000. No wonder the pigs went and committed suicide. Overload. They just slided down the hill and killed themselves because of too much of weight. This is a scenario that actually happened. The demons made their own arrangements to leave this man. Literally thousands of demons are begging Jesus, would you please deliver us from these Christians? Honestly, why do you torment us before our time? Demons are getting tormented living with Christians. That's the truth. They're being tormented. You are the Holy Son of God. They know He is God Almighty. The devil, beautiful, the devil recognized Jesus. And these people were sitting with the Bible, sitting in the front row. Those without the Bible are better than you. Pastor, what did I do? Sitting with a Bible in the front row, did not recognize Jesus coming to where we are gathered in one accord. If we come religiously, because you have to attend a church service, you and I are not better than. But you come. It's not how many come, it's how you come. We are not interested in the numbers, we are interested in the members of the body of Christ. Titles doesn't help you. Books don't help you. Your head, knowledge doesn't help us. And look at the scripture. My goodness. John, 1 John. I'm going to finish in 5 minutes. How many times I have to say that? So how many times I've said now? Keep counting. Man, I never preached this kind of a message anywhere else. Wow. 1 John. No. From the very first day, we were there, taking it all in. We heard it with our own ears, saw it with our own eyes, verified it with our own hands. So, when is the first day? Is it the first day of discipleship or first day of resurrection? Verified it with our own hands. They touched. The word of life appeared right before our eyes. We saw it happen. Appear. The word of life appeared. When were their eyes open? He opened their mind. He opened their heart to know that he is the Messiah. Unless and until he opens our eyes, we cannot see. Open our eyes that we may see wonderful things in your scriptures. Who has to open? The Holy Spirit has to open. And now we are telling you in most sober prose that we have witnessed was incredibly this. This infinite life of God himself took shape before us. We saw it, we heard it, and now we are telling you so you can experience it. You have to experience him. Experiencing it along with us. What is that experience? He explains that also. This experience of communion with the Father and his Son Jesus Christ. Our motive for writing is simply this. We want you to enjoy this too. Your joy will become double joy. The message we heard, we are passing to you. God is light, pure light. There's no trace of darkness in him. If we claim that you have experienced a shared life and continue to stumble around in the religion, we are obviously lying through our teeth. We are not living what we claim. Believing in him happens only when you be living in him. If you continue to be living in him, helps you to believe in him. If you're not living in him, you cannot believe in him. Sounds same, but means different. So which comes first? Living in him helps us to believe in him. That's what he's talking about. It goes on. If we claim that we are free of sin, we are only fooling ourselves. We experience a shared life with one another as a sacrificed blood. Okay, let's go back to Philippians. Let me wind up. Second, maybe in another way, okay. If you've got anything out of all this, following Christ, Philippians 2nd chapter, he took on the status of a slave. The Son of God became Son of Man to make the Son of Man a Son of God. That is the ultimate purpose of God coming to earth. To take us, he didn't want to come down to have pity party with us. Oh, poor mankind, I'm here to help you, wipe your tears, clean you from the pit, clean you from the muck and the mire, the slimy pit, you know, and put you back over there. No! He didn't come for us to have first servicing, second servicing, third servicing, car servicing, laundry servicing. We don't believe in servicing. We don't go to the crucifix to have a fix. But he came to give us a permanent fix. So he didn't come to repair. He came to replace us. He didn't come to repair us, repair our heart, repair our life, bless us. No. He came to make us a blessing to nations. He came to make us like Him. Live like Him. Not try to. The moment you try to, I am praying hard, you fail. That's religion. I prayed and God gave me this. Finished. You got your reward. Oh, I prayed for those prayer points. God answered all those prayer points. He didn't answer because you prayed. He answered in spite of your prayer. That's religion. If you think you prayed and God answered, does it mean that we should not pray? No. We pray. We agree. What is prayer? Agree with Him according to His will and say what He's saying. It's done to you on earth as it is done in heaven. Prayer is not forcing His hand. God, you better do this. I'm fasting for 40 days. You have to give me my job. Otherwise, I'm going to break your hands. Fasting will not produce a miracle. Fasting brings you closer to Him. Coming close to Him produces the miracle. I hope you understand what I'm saying. Yeah, I prayed for this to happen. No. Many people say prayer changes things. No. We see that everywhere, so many houses. Prayer doesn't change things for us. Prayer changes us for things. I repeat again. Prayer does not change things for us. Prayer changes us for things, and then automatically things change. Because we are the change. We don't look for change. Change happens in us. Another quote that was going on in my mind. This is to inform that if you don't transform, you only conform to perform. I'll repeat. This is to inform that if you don't transform, you only conform to perform. It's only performance. We are pushed to perform as Christians. We are pushed to perform. So dangerous. So dangerous. 2 o'clock in the morning, I put a quote on the Instagram. Did you watch it? No. My status. No, you are all sleeping. I was. Don't look for. No. My phone, please. It's divine to look for a diamond in the dirt than for dirt in the diamond. Going above the head. It's better that you look for a diamond in the dirt than looking for dirt on the diamond. Don't look for problem in every solution. Look for solution in every problem. In other words, pessimist always look for problems in every solution. You give them a solution, adhula or water. But an optimist looks for solution in every problem. It's your perspective. So my words, don't look for dirt in the diamond. There is dirt, but our job is to remove the dirt. That's what we are here for. Not to throw the diamond because it's got dirt. You're throwing away your opportunity. Every person whom you meet in your office is a diamond in disguise sent by God for you to remove the dirt. If you don't remove the dirt in the people, who are with you in the office, God will not waste his time removing the dirt from your life. Instead of bringing people to church, become the church which you reach out to people. Don't try to bring people to church. That's a wrong thing to do. Don't wait for people to come to your church. You become the church and let people come to you, and you become the transforming agent for them. Let them see Christ in you, because they cannot see Christ in the church. If Christ was there in the church, there would be transformation. There would be lives changing. People would be drawn. So God never intended a building to become a church. He wanted us to become a church. If you try to get people into a church building, it is religion again. It's religion. What's a religion? Legion in every region. Operating through a system. Christian system, religious system. I don't know why I'm sharing all this to you people. Supposed to be Philippians 2. Okay, if you've got anything, you mean to say, I mean, the reason why Paul used if was, he was actually slapping our face. He's actually slapping us. That's an insult. I mean, if you got anything out of following Christ, what should you say to Paul? What do you mean, Paul? What do you mean if? You mean to say, did we get anything? No, we got everything. Yeah. Amen? We got everything. Our very life, our very existence. Today I am breathing. Today I am alive. Today I am wearing this nice shirt is because I follow him. Amen? Everything that we have, everything that was created, everything that exists, the planet, the sun, the moon, and the star, everything is for him. To him. By him and in him, right? So what should we read? Yes. When I have gotten everything out of following Christ, yes, I've got his love. No, his love, when his love has made so much difference in my life, when being in a community, this is not church, this is come in unity. This is communion. This is the breaking of the bread. This is the drinking of the wine. The wine is the Holy Spirit speaking to us. Understanding the word is the bread. Not taking the chapati and the sambar and dipping in your mouth, putting in your mouth. That's symbolic. If you don't do this and you do that, you miss the whole thing. We should do that, but what should come first? What if we don't do this and we do that? We bring death on ourselves. Paul says it. I don't want to bring death every 2 months for you. Once in 2 months. I want to bring life every day. If you're convicted with the word, you go home and you take on puppet and say, Lord, I believe, thank you for your word. The word that I heard, this is symbolic. I break it, dip it, and the rasam, and I take it. You have partaken. You can, that's okay. Joshua Paul is preaching a heresy. He's telling us to take puppet and rasam. Okay, you want to be spiritual, there is some bread and wine in the fridge. You can take it and go, do it in your home. There's nothing wrong taking communion by yourself, kneeling down, reading the word with tears on your eyes, and take the bread and the wine in your own home. Jesus will be there with you. We'll be there with you. Don't wait for some pastor to come back from America and give you communion on Easter Sunday. I hope you understand what I'm saying. Don't be dependent on this. I don't want to use the word jokers. It's okay. We want to waste your relationship or drain your relationship or get your relationship based on works. No, let your relationship be based on the word. On the word, on the word. Not on works. I can do it every week, every day. If you could come every day. That's not the point. Breaking of bread and the wine is the Holy Spirit. Amen? Okay, that's not an excuse. Okay, being in the community, that's communion of the Spirit. If it means, it means everything to me. I have, am I the only one reading it? I have a heart and I care. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. I repeat again. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you really care. If they know that you care for them, you will make a difference every day in your office. Every day in your office. So take this to another notch. Then do me a favor. Agree with each other. Why does Paul talk about agreeing with each other? So important. Love each other. That's what she said. Be deep-spirited friends. Love those people. Next verse, please. Don't push your way to the front. Beautiful. Don't sweet talk your way to the top. It's two different words. Put yourself aside and help others go ahead. Don't block the way for others, but make way for others. That's true Christianity. Impacting people in your office. Do you know that you take this blessed hands and lay hands on someone, the fire of God flows into that person, and the breath of God flows into the person, and that person will have a God encounter. It happens with everyone in this room, not just me. I lay hands on cancer, they get healed. Why? I believe the one who lives in me is greater than the one who lives in that person. Is greater than that cancer. And I can do it in a street. I can do it anywhere. Not in a Christian atmosphere. No. It doesn't happen in a Christmas atmosphere. It happened in a Chinese atmosphere. Chinese temple. It happened in a mosque. It happened in a Gurdwara. In a Gurdwara surrounded by 400 strong Punjabi priests. The presence of God could come and touch a man and he comes running. I'm healed. Another priest comes running. I'm healed. Another priest comes running. Then I realized that God wants to heal people outside the church then by bringing them into a church. Why? You cannot keep Christ in Christianity or churchianity. You have to take him out. All that the devil has been trying to do with us is take us in the opposite direction. We should wake up and turn around and go in the opposite direction. The way God intended it for us. Let's read the next verse. Help others to get ahead. Don't be obsessed with getting your own advantage. What blessing I will get? It's not about you getting advantage. Why don't you lose your advantage and allow another person to be promoted instead of you? Let others overtake you. Forget yourselves long enough to lend a helping hand. Okay, this is message translation. Next verse, please. Keep going. Think of yourself the way Christ Jesus thought of himself. There it is. Think. Wait. Don't rush. Think of yourself. Change the way you think. Change the way you live. Change the way you think. Start thinking like Christ. Are you able to understand that? What is he thinking? Sit on the chair and think God thoughts. What is God doing in heaven? Scratching his head.
How can I get a new house? How can I get a promotion? How can I reach the world? How can I get soul saved? Do you think those are his thoughts? No. No. Find out what are his thoughts. Next verse, please. I can dwell on the scripture for ages. He had equal status. Look at his status. His WhatsApp status, Facebook status, Insta status. He had equal status with God, but didn't think so much of himself. What's C.S. Lewis' definition of humility? Humility is not thinking of yourself lesser, opposite. Not thinking less of yourself, but thinking of yourself less. Thinking of less. So, how did Paul get this revelation? By going through the persecution. You can never get a revelation from God without persecution. If you're not getting persecuted for your identity in Christ, who you are in Christ, threat to the devil is a treat from God. If you're not a threat to the devil, you're not getting a treat from God. You want God's treat? You need to be a threat to the devil. The devil must see you as an enemy. The devil must see you as a threat. The devil must see you with an angry face. Then God is very happy. My son, you've done something. You got the attention of the devil. You need to get the attention of the devil every day. Early in the morning, first. But I like it. When I get up, where is the devil? Before I keep my leg down, I look for the devil as my footrest. Hello? When we get up from the bed, avana mele medichira adutha step. If you are not a threat to the devil, you cannot get a treat from God. That's a treat from God. Powerful. He had equal status with God, but didn't think so much of himself that he had to cling to the advantages of the state. So he had to let go of everything that was advantageous for him. Will I do it? No. Will you do it? No. But with Christ with us, we can do it. We have to let go of everything that is advantageous to us. Okay? Cling to the advantages of that status no matter what. And then next. Then I'm coming to the point. Not at all. When the time came, the fullness of time, he set aside the privilege of being a deity, and took on the status of a slave, became human. Do you know how John Wesley got saved? Do you know how revival broke out Azusa Street? Do you know how the current Pentecostal movement started? All because of the Moravians who were born in the royal family. Moravians, Count Zinzendorf. Google and find out. Moravians. So John Wesley was a preacher, was a pastor. And he was preaching in the Anglican church, or preaching in the Church of England of those days. And he knew the Bible. He knew the word. He was a great preacher, John Wesley. But while he was traveling in the boat wearing the white gown and cassock and the Bible in his hand with books, because he's going to deliver lectures. And there he finds these people who are smiling and laughing, washing one another's feet, cleaning the bed, helping people. And people are laughing at them because they were serving one another. And he saw the joy on their face. And he saw them praying. He saw them singing. He said, "Who are you people?" So we are filled with the Holy Spirit. We are filled with Jesus. What are you doing? No, we belong to the royal family. But we chose to become slaves to help people without salary so that they will know Jesus through us. Moravians, John Wesley kept all his book aside, knelt down, and he said, "Can I have the joy that you people have?" He said, "You need the Holy Spirit." "What do you mean I need the Holy Spirit? Jesus is in my heart, I have the Holy Spirit." "You don't have the joy of the Holy Spirit. You need to have the fullness of the Holy Spirit. You need to have the baptism of the Holy Spirit." He said, "What is all this? Can you explain?" They explained. They laid hands on him. He was filled in the Holy Spirit. He was gloriously filled in the Holy Spirit. He was for many days, many weeks, laughing, giggling, joyful, singing, dancing, celebrating of being filled in the Holy Spirit. And then he goes and starts the Methodist movement. The revival broke out after that. It's all connected. Moravians. Why am I saying this? This is what they did. They were royal family. They were had a high status, but they left all to become. I'm not telling we should do that, but in a way, we can help somebody, encourage somebody. Do something to someone. Are you listening? Wow. Okay, next verse, please. Having become human, he stayed human. It was an incredible, humbling process. What did Jesus go through? Incredibly humbling process. Are you willing to go? If you are Christ in, if you have Christ in, you, we have to do this. He didn't claim special privileges. Instead, he lived a, can we read it together, please? Selfless, obedient life, and then died a selfless, obedient death. And the worst kind of death at that, a crucifixion. And then, this comes the beautiful verse. Next verse, please. Because of that obedience, God lifted him high and honored him far beyond anyone or anything or ever. Next verse. So that all created beings in heaven and on earth, even those long ago dead and buried, will bow in worship before this Jesus Christ. And then? And call out in praise that he is the master of all to the glorious honor of God. Okay, the previous verse, verse 10 in Amplified or King James. 10, yeah, put another. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. Those in heaven and those on earth and of those under the earth. Now, when we sing about the name of Jesus, every time you sing the name of Jesus, it doesn't talk about every human being should bow their knees. Not only that, but every principality, every power, every dominion, every authority, every evil spirit in this locality, in this nation, and in the nations around, when you sing the name of Jesus, they bow down. Whether you know it or not, whether you like it or not, whether you think about it or not, they bow their knees to the name of Jesus. The old spirit world, even thousands and millions of angels in heaven, then bow down when you people sing about the name of Jesus. Which we didn't even know. We're just sitting comfortably, name of Jesus, name of Jesus. But they know. That in the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue. Can we sing that song again?